When we ended last week, we just finished looking at the parable of the wedding feast in Matthew 22, 1 to 14. Now this, as you can see, this is the third parable in the category that I have of the kingdom is bad news for the establishment. And it's the last in a sequence of three parables in Matthew, all of which speak of the Jewish leadership's rejection of God's kingdom call. So you have this sequence of three parables, Matthew 22, 1 to 14 being the last one. And the first point of the parable is that those not expected to be at the feast, those initially not invited, they end up receiving the king's bounty. Whereas those who are expected to be at the feast, those initially invited, they end up receiving the king's wrath. This is the same kind of reversal that you see in the two preceding parables. The parable of the two sons, where the tax collectors and the prostitutes enter the kingdom ahead of, meaning in place of, the religious elite. And it's you see in the parable of the wicked tenants, where the kingdom is forfeited by its presumptive recipients and it's given to others. So you see the same reversal that goes on in this third parable in that sequence. The second point of the parable that's expressed in the man who was condemned for not wearing a wedding garment is that accepting the invitation to the kingdom feast, accepting that invitation carries a commitment to be properly respectful to the king. One cannot accept the invitation to the kingdom of God in a spirit of defiance. Can't accept that invitation with this attitude that I am going to remain in charge. I'm going to do things my way. Can't accept it with an intention to give God less than his due. One accepts the invitation to the kingdom in brokenness, in repentance, in a spirit that is bowed down before God, grateful for the gift, not with attitude. See, not with making a statement. Verse 14 in Matthew 22, it sums up the parable. Many are invited, but see, fewer than that are chosen to receive the blessings because fewer than that will respond to the invitation in genuine faith. Now, I want to say a little bit about the parallel parable that is in Luke chapter 14 verses 16 to 24. The version of the parable that Jesus tells on that occasion, it's told in reply to a statement that is made to Jesus in Luke 14:15. Blessed is the man who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God. Now Daryl Bach, commenting on that statement, he says, in all likelihood, the person making the statement, that statement of 14:15, blessed is the man who will eat at the feast of the kingdom of God, the person making that statement was saying that it will be great when blessing one day comes to all those present. So here they are, they're at this gathering, and he says, blessed is the one, or blessed is the man who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God, meaning all of us. You see, and I think that's what he's saying. So Bach says, in all likelihood, the person making the statement was saying that it will be great when blessing one day comes to all those present. The image is the fellowship at the banquet table of God in the end. You see, it's the consummated kingdom, that kingdom feast. Jesus responds with yet another parable about a banquet. He challenges the optimistic assumption of the remark. So this guy's saying it's going to be great when we're all there in the kingdom feast. And Jesus says with this parable, there's going to be a reversal of expectations. You're assuming and thinking that all of you are going to be there, but it's not going to work that way. Those who you don't expect are going to end up being there. Those you expect are not going to be there. So he tells this version. Now the parable in Luke, it differs in a number of ways from the parable in Matthew, but the storyline of the two parables is the same. It's basically the same. You have a man of wealth and status who goes to trouble and expense to prepare a great feast, after the people he invited said they would come. And when he summons the invitees to the feast that he's prepared, they all snub him. Same storyline. The host, in the face of that insult, he then sends out servants to gather all kinds of people to come and attend the feast. So that's the common storyline of both versions of the parable. Now, in Luke's version, the man is not a king, and he's hosting a great banquet rather than a wedding feast. There's no mention of a son. But again, the storyline is the same, but those details differ. The guests are summoned only one time after the feast, unlike the version in Matthew. The servant doing the summoning to tell them to come to the feast, he's not mistreated, unlike the version in Matthew. And the excuses given by the invitees for reneging on their prior acceptance, they go into a lot of detail about that in Luke's version. But still, what they're doing is they're saying, no, they're snubbing the person who's throwing the feast. In Luke, there are two waves of substitute guests, the first of which is identified as the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. And in Luke, there's no parable to the man who's improperly attired. You know, the first person who comes in not wearing the wedding garment. So there's no parallel to that. But the parable in Luke makes the point that's also made in Matthew's version that those not expected to be at the feast, those not initially invited, they end up there. Whereas those expected to be at the feast, those initially invited, they end up being excluded. You see, the Jewish leaders who seem to be sitting pretty, is the way we'd say it. They seem to be sitting pretty religiously. The Jewish leaders who are in that category, they're not going to be in the kingdom because they are rejecting God's summons. Here is Jesus announcing the kingdom. And what are they going to do? They're going to reject that call. So those who appear to be sitting pretty, the Jewish leaders, are not going to be there because they're going to reject God's summons, whereas those they consider outcasts of both society and God, they're going to be in the kingdom because they are accepting Jesus' summons to come to the feast, to enter the kingdom, to fall in behind him. So that's what's going on. Now the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame, that's an especially fitting representation of those not expected to enter the kingdom, because in addition to being social outcasts, which is what those people were, those with physical defects, they were considered by some Jews, such as the Essenes from the Qumran community, you know, the Dead Sea Scrolls. Well, those with these physical defects were considered by some Jews to be disqualified from the kingdom. So they're a really fitting image or picture of those not expected to be in the kingdom feast. Craig Evans, who's a New Testament scholar, commenting on the Qumran documents, he says in his commentary, he says, Jesus' parable suggests that the very persons thought to be disqualified, basically, according to the stipulations of Leviticus 21, 17 to 23, from the final holy battle of the last days and from the messianic feast that follows, would end up being the very people who will participate in this celebration, while ironically and tragically, none of those people who were invited will get a taste of my banquet. And so it's this idea, the same idea, reversal. Those you expect, the religious leaders, these ethnic Jews who are in the leadership positions of the society who are going to reject the summons by rejecting Jesus, they are not going to enter the kingdom. The outcasts, this quote, sinners, the tax collectors and prostitutes who are saying yes to the invitation, those you would never expect would be in the kingdom of God when you compare them to these holy Pharisee-type people. Well, they are, in fact, are going to enter the kingdom. Now, the second gathering effort in Luke's version of the parable, the second gathering effort of these previously uninvited guests, it emphasizes the room that's available at the feast. You see, we go out and get one group, then we go out and get another group. Well, that's the point, you see, is that there's tremendous room available at the feast, and it emphasizes the depth of God's desire for a full house. God is not stingy with the invitation. It's not like he says, well, you know, I got enough people. I don't want to get too many. That's not how he is. He wants the place packed. And so he's going out, and that's you see that it is emphasized there. Now, that they must be compelled in Luke's version, in the sense of socially urged to attend. That reinforces the unexpectedness of their presence at the feast. See, they're reluctant because they see the honor of attending the feast as too great for one of their status and as something for which they could never reciprocate. They require convincing that they're really wanted at the banquet in the city. So you see, how unexpected is it? These people have to be compelled in the sense of socially urged because they feel themselves that we're not worthy. We can't be there. That's not for us. But it is. You see, it is. And that's the kingdom. So you could see in that regard, I could have put this in, it's good news for the needy. That's why I told you. See, some of these things will fit. You could put them. And I just took what I thought was the major thrust, and that's how I categorized them. Next category of parables I want to look at least the way I've grouped them, is the call to a kingdom decision. And the first one is the narrow gate and way from Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. Now, as I hope you will recall, those of you who were in here for the lessons on the Sermon on the Mount, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus exhorts his disciples. He exhorts kingdom participants. He exhorts his followers to live radically righteous lives, to live a righteousness that exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees. In Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 through 11, he speaks of the source and the means for doing so, the power of God that is available through prayer. That is the source and means by which we live these distinctive lives, these radically righteous lives. So he says that in 7, 7 through 11. And then in chapter 7, verse 12, he renews his exhortation to kingdom living, which he's been giving them throughout the sermon. But he renews that exhortation this time in terms of the golden rule, the principle that captures the essence of the Old Testament's ethical direction. And you can see that, for example, in Romans 13, 8 through 10. You know, we give the Old Testament a bad name. But this is the essence of the Old Testament's ethical direction. As I've said many times, the fundamental ethical requirement, the center, the bullseye, the heart of the Christian ethical requirement is love. You can see that in Matthew chapter 7, verse 12, Matthew 22, 37 to 40. You see it in Romans 13, 8 through 10. You can see it in Galatians 5, 14. That is the center of the Christian ethical requirement. But love is not some shapeless, amorphous sentiment that is detached from conduct. It's not simply, I kind of have this warm feeling. That's not what it is. It is not that shapeless sentiment that's detached from conduct. Some specific conduct is loving, and some specific conduct is not loving. Love is the center, but there are definite requirements on how love expresses itself. As Paul indicates in Romans chapter 13, verse 9, the command to love your neighbor as yourself, that command, he says, encompasses, it includes the commands of the law not to commit adultery, not to murder, not to steal, not to covet, and other commands of the law that he doesn't specify. So you see, there's a command to love, But that command has content. So it's the center is love, but there are specific requirements of what that means. You don't get to live however you want to live and then say, by your definition, that's loving. There is real content to what it means to love. So the command to love your neighbor as yourself encompasses the command not to sleep with his wife, not to steal from him, not to covet. You see? That's the idea. It is this umbrella command that encompasses all these more specific commandments. So the Christian, though not being under the Mosaic law, I don't have time to go through all of this, but I've gone through it many times before. The Christian is not under the Mosaic law in the sense that the Christian is not under the set, the package, the unit of commands that are part of the Mosaic covenant. But the Christian, though not being under the Mosaic law, upholds the transcendent moral requirements that are included in that law, such as not committing adultery, not stealing, not coveting, what Paul identifies in 13:9. You see, it includes these transcendent moral requirements that were embedded in that covenant. They didn't begin with that covenant. They're embedded there and they continue afterwards as part of this Christian ethical requirement of loving one another. So you see, that's what's going on. This ongoing moral law that is centered in love, this is what is meant by the law of Christ that Paul refers to in 1 Corinthians 9:21. You can also see Galatians 6:2 with Galatians 5:14. This idea of the law of Christ. Now, right after summarizing their ethical duty in terms of the golden rule, Jesus in Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, he says, "Enter by the narrow gate. For the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few." As I explained when we went through the Sermon on the Mount, the narrow gate, as I see it, is Jesus Christ. He is the narrow gate through which one enters into life. Jesus says in John 10:9, "I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture." And he's a narrow gate. He's a narrow gate, not only because the allegiance that is given to Jesus cannot be shared with any other. See, he's exclusive. "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." It is not one among many. Jesus is one in a panoply of gods. No, he's narrow in the way that the allegiance that is given to him is not shared with any others. But it's also narrow in the sense that the life that follows from faith in him, a life of discipleship, is restrictive compared to the broad way of life of those who do not call him master. John Stott, in his commentary on the Sermon on the Mount, he says, "One way is easy. There's plenty of room on it for diversity of opinions and laxity of morals. It is the road of tolerance and permissiveness. It has no curbs, no boundaries of either thought or conduct. Travelers on this road follow their own inclinations." That is the desires of the human heart in its fallenness. And that's what our society says is the highest ethics. Just follow your heart. I think, why would I want to do that? You can't go wrong. Just follow your heart. I mean, what do you mean follow my heart? I want to follow what is good and right and noble and holy. That's what I want to follow. And whatever my heart says, if it says something, it says, well, you know, part of me is being pulled over here. I need to grab it and take it and say, no, you are going to go and live this way. But anyway, that's our society. And kids get this stuff pumped into them in cartoons and everything else. All right. "Travelers on the road follow their own inclination. That is the desires of the human heart and its fallenness. Superficiality, self-love, hypocrisy, mechanical religion, false ambition, censoriousness. These things do not have to be learnt or cultivated. Effort is needed to resist them. No effort is required to practice them. That is why the broad road is easy." You see, the path of discipleship, the path of being a Christian, is difficult or hard in that it requires restraint, it requires discipline, and it requires self-denial. We hate hearing that. Like I say, our mantra is, deny yourself nothing, follow your heart. The truth is, you are to deny yourself because you have desires and impulses that until that day are corrupt. So you have to grab that and deny it and march with the Lord. And so in that sense, you see, it's narrow, it's difficult, but paradoxically, those who embrace that way, those who are all in, those who say, yes, I'm following you, Lord Jesus, those who make that surrender, they find that the Lord's yoke is easy and His burden is light. So yes, it is, there's a sense of denial and discipline in these things, but those who take the plunge, you see, not simply saying words, not simply getting wet, but those who give their heart, soul, and life to Jesus Christ, who are baptized into Him in that spirit and heart, well, then it's the road, the burden is light. Why? Because we have stepped through the looking glass, as my brother and I always say. Our world has completely changed. How we see reality, how we see this world and life. And so you have that paradoxical aspect. Now the destination of discipleship, a destination of this road of following Jesus, is life, meaning eternal fellowship with God in the consummated kingdom. Whereas the destination of the broad gate and the easy road, where that winds up, the way that's taken by many who are spiritually complacent, that destination is ruin. It is ruin. Separation from God, which is hell. And as I say, Jesus speaks of this more than anyone. And we have the audacity in our culture to label talking about that as unloving. I said, well, you're going to lecture the Lord about it? Are you going to come here and tell Jesus, you know, Lord, you were pretty great, you know? When you made the quasars and you did all that stuff, you knew what you were doing. But I got to tell you, you know, just like Peter, come over here. Let me tell you something. You got to stop this talk about two ways and one of them ending up separated from you. People don't want to hear that. Do you think the Lord knows what people need to hear? I do. You see, I do. And I think we need to say it just like the Lord said it. David Turner, in his commentary on Matthew, he says, the wide path that promised freedom has ended in separation from God. But when one takes the difficult step of entering the narrow gate, although the path of discipleship is very arduous, we don't want to say it. We don't want to say to somebody. We want to tell them, listen, no, no, no. You don't have to change anything. You don't have to worry about it. You don't have to repent of your sin. You don't have to sit here and see these things and say, I renounce them. My drunkenness, my sexual immorality, my vulgarity, my obscenity, all of that. You don't have to, look, don't make a big deal about it. It's all about, you just come in and say the magic words. And you just come in and you just keep living like you want, but we want you to be at peace. We are lying to people if we tell them that. You see, we're lying to them if we tell them that. He says here that, but when one takes the difficult step of entering the narrow gate, although the path of discipleship is very arduous, suddenly one is ushered into eternal life. The rugged path that threatened to destroy has ended in one sharing in the life of God and His kingdom. Those who take the easy road find to their horror that it leads to the most difficult destination imaginable. But those who take the difficult path of the kingdom arrive joyously in the kingdom to experience life with the Father. This is where the road ends, in the consummated kingdom. You see, in that perfect reality of love and fellowship, in which there'll be no death, no mourning, no crying, no pain, no suffering. We will share in that absolute joyful place forever. And that's, see, so that's something we need to say. We need to say and to tell people. And the challenge of Christ's call, it remains today. Join the revolution. You see, when somebody like you, if you imagine a revolution with Cuba, you pick some place where there's a revolution. People understand that you're in the revolution, you see, or you're not. There's not this thing, well, you know, I'm kind of, you either join it or you don't. And so that's what Christ calls us to fall in behind Him, to join this revolution that the kingdom bringer, the Lord Jesus Christ, to fall in behind Him. See? Trusting in Him for life and giving Him your wholehearted allegiance. That's what's involved. Choose to follow Jesus with devotion and seriousness. Not with pretend. Not with, you know, I think this is kind of nice. I like the people. There's a good crowd. And I think there's a good opportunity here for this or that. No, because you see who Jesus is and you give Him your life. So then wherever you are, wherever you go, wherever you move, what do? Well, I just couldn't find a good church. I didn't like. You are a disciple because you've given Jesus your life. And so you fall in behind Him. You choose to follow Him with devotion and seriousness. See, braced for the difficulty that discipleship brings in this overlap of ages. And knowing the glory that awaits you. You see, we know that. And we live for Jesus that way. Second parable in this group, the call to kingdom decision, is the narrow door. In Luke 13:23, Jesus is asked by someone, Lord, will those who are saved be few? Will those who are saved be few? And Jesus says in Luke 13:24-28, strive to enter through the narrow door. For many, I tell you, will seek to enter and will not be able. When once the master of the house has risen and shut the door, and you begin to stand outside and to knock at the door saying, Lord, open to us, then he will answer you, I do not know you. I do not know where you come from. That's a way of saying I have no relationship with you. I do not know where you come from. Then you will begin to say, we ate and drank in your presence and you taught in our streets. But he will say, I tell you, I do not know where you come from. Depart from me, all you workers of evil. I do not know where you come from. We got nothing. Depart from me, all you workers of evil. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Jesus, you can't talk that way. Weeping and gnashing of teeth? That sounds bad. Well, it is bad. It's a picture of the worst it can get. All right, weeping and gnashing of teeth. When you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourselves cast out. You yourselves cast out. The way of salvation, the way into the kingdom feast, is described as a narrow door through which Jesus calls his hearers to strive to enter. To strive to enter. Strive, it's an athletic metaphor. It's an athletic metaphor that was used in the Greek world and in Greek influenced Judaism with respect to the practice of virtue and obedience to the law of God. See, the way into the feast, the way into this kingdom feast involves a faith that includes a genuine, heartfelt surrender to the will of God, a genuine repentance. You cannot come in with bogus, oh yes, I believe in Him. Oh yes, He is Lord. If there is not brokenness of heart and spirit that says, I'm following You. I'm giving You my life. What You call me to do, I will live that way. There will be no entrance into the kingdom. You cannot fake God out. You have to hear this. The church has to say this. Because it does no good to tell people. You can schmooze your way in. It is a thing. When you come to faith, there is this question of, now that you come to this intellectual understanding, you are now in the valley of decision. Until you believe that, you don't have a decision to make. Once you believe it, the question is now, will you follow Him as Lord? Will you follow Him as Lord? And that's what you're seeing here. That's what's involved. One must strive to enter while the opportunity to do so exists. There is an urgency because the door is going to be closed at some point. We think we're going to live a long time in all of this. I just saw Hot Rod Williams. Some of you follow basketball. He just died at age 53. John Hot Rod Williams played for the Cavaliers. I'm old enough to know him. 53. When you're in your 20s, you think 53 is old. When you're 63, you say, man, that guy's a pup. But you see, we think this idea, well, no, but there's an urgency here. There's an urgency because the door is going to be closed at some point, whether by death or by the Lord's return, at which time entry will no longer be possible. And those who refuse to commit their lives to surrender to the Lord Jesus Christ when they had the opportunity to do so, they will be locked out. And appeals to casual involvement with Jesus will change nothing. But I went to church. But my grandma's faithful. That's this idea. Well, we ate with you and you taught in our streets. We had some marginal connection to you. That's not going to matter. You see, you'll be pleading those kinds of marginal things, but I did this and I did that. The question is, did you give your life to Jesus? Did you fall in behind Him as a disciple so that when He says, the thing you're doing, the way you're acting, the way you're treating your wife, the way you're treating your husband is wrong, you said, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. It is shameful to me that in the church, we have relationships the way that we have them. People who are committed to Jesus, who will not surrender and change. Right? It is shameful that this happens. We are people who love the Lord and have given Him our lives, right? So we can call one another. No, you need to be changing toward Him. And husbands and wives, then you'll be growing closer together. That's how it is. You don't get a pass to say, well, I think I'm just going to be the way I want to. You said you're following Jesus. Now, is that real or isn't it? Are we a social club or a church? That's the thing. That's the thing. And that's what Jesus talks about everywhere. Everywhere. It's not just here. See, we have to be able, we have to be willing to do this. We have to strive. This minimal kind of contact and stuff, running around the perimeter of Christianity, on that day, that will mean absolutely nothing. The owner will say, depart from me, all you workers of evil. See, which shows that their exclusion is a function of their refusal to take seriously the demands of discipleship. Why does he say, depart from me, all you workers, you see, all you workers of iniquity. Why does he say that? All you workers of evil, depart from me, all you workers of evil. That's what he says. And he says that, you see, that shows you that the exclusion is a function of a refusal to be genuine in your brokenness and submission, not to follow Jesus as Lord. But if, yeah, oh, yeah, yeah, I have the, oh, I say that, I go to church. I go to church and then I live the way I want to. Well, what's he going to say? Depart from me, you workers of evil. Because there is no reality to your profession, to your confession of faith. They will be excluded from the kingdom feast, consigned to a place where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. David Wenham commenting on the parable, he says, the point is simple. Failure to live out the way of God's revolution with its higher righteousness and law of love is fatal. We may compare Paul's warnings about baptism without obedience being a recipe for disaster. The earliest baptismal creed was probably Jesus is Lord. And about our spiritual gifts without revolutionary love being useless. Joining the revolution is not just a matter of words of allegiance, but of following Jesus in serious, costly commitment. You understand that? That's when really the things, when it's difficult to be a disciple. When your wife's driving you crazy. Not that mine would. But see, that's when it's difficult. That's when you submit and surrender all the more and say, why? Because my Lord calls me to be this way. That's when you're down and out and have difficulties and you're tempted to lie and cheat and steal. Well, you see, that's when you honor Him. You see, that's the movie Cinderella Man. I've mentioned it to you before. It's about, I think, the guy, fighter is James Braddock. It's based on his life, heavyweight champion, I think, in the 30s, depression. And one of the lines I love in there, his kid was caught stealing something in a store. Depression, you know, he wants something. And his dad took him and he said, however things are, we don't steal. See, that doesn't excuse doing wrong. However things are, we don't steal. And that's this idea that's where you're being tested in your loyalty and faithfulness when it's difficult. When it's smooth sailing. You see, well, what do I put first? Part of you can say, I want to do this. This looks like a good thing. You know, I can lie here, cheat here, steal here, do this, do that. And you say, no, I'm a disciple. I've given my life to Jesus Christ. And so that's really where this thing happens and comes in. So you see this idea of this following, this serious commitment. Third one, two houses in the call to a kingdom decision. Now, many are convinced that I mentioned this during the Sermon on the Mount, that Matthew's Sermon on the Mount and Luke's Sermon on the Plain, many are convinced that they're two different accounts of the same occasion. I don't think that's the case. I lean strongly to the sense that Matthew and Luke's accounts, they're sermons that were delivered by Jesus on two separate occasions. So I take the parable of the two houses in Matthew 7:24 and Luke 6:47 and 49 as variations of a parable that Jesus told at the end of the two sermons. He has a variation there. Now I'm only going to discuss the version in Matthew in 7:24-27, as the differences in the parables there in Matthew and Luke's version are minor, and the parable functions essentially in the same way in both Gospels. So I'm just going to discuss Matthew. Matthew 7:24-27. Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. Now Jesus concludes his Sermon on the Mount with this parable illustrating the wise man's choice. He's been through this parable where he's been preaching, exhorting people to radical righteousness. He says, listen, I understand, but you have to see what it means as the kingdom bringer, when I call you to come and participate in the kingdom and to fall in behind me as king, that you are coming and you are coming to live as my disciples, which involves a radical righteousness. And then he spells out how radical it is. He doesn't soft soap it. He doesn't sit here and say, listen, don't you worry about it. He comes and says, saying yes to the kingdom call is the biggest thing you're ever going to say yes to. And so he goes through this whole thing and he's saying that. And then he gives them this at the end, this idea of this parable that illustrates the wise man's choice. And it serves to underscore the significance of his teaching in the sermon and to urge obedience to his teaching. We have to take this seriously. Those who become true disciples, those who have a genuine faith in the Lord Jesus that expresses itself in obedience to his words. That's what biblical saving faith is. Again, it is not simply intellectual assent. It is not some abstract belief. It is understanding those truths, but saying yes to them, lock, stock, and barrel, heart, soul, spirit. I am going to live according to those things. You see, so the person who become true disciples, who have a genuine faith that expresses itself in obedience to Jesus' words, they're like a wise man. They're like the wise man who built his house on a rock. And just as a house built on rock can withstand the devastation of a physical storm, disciples, those of genuine biblical obedience-producing faith, disciples will withstand the great storm of the final judgment. Those who never come to a saving faith, those who never come to an obedience-producing faith, but continue to live without putting Jesus' words into practice, are like a foolish man who built his house on sand. You see, just as the house on sand will not withstand the devastation of a physical storm, those who are not true disciples will not withstand the great storm of the final judgment. David Wenham, he summarizes the meaning of this parable this way. The parable of the two houses explains that the deciding factor on that day will quite simply be people's response to Jesus' word. The contrast is between those who hear these words of mine and do them, and those who hear and do not do them. This is a natural enough emphasis at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, but it is, of course, the emphasis throughout Jesus' teaching. He has brought the word of the kingdom, and for all its apparent weakness, the kingdom's apparent weakness, you know, its seeming hiddenness and its subtlety that we've talked about, despite its apparent weakness and insignificance emphasized in the parables of growth, it is, in fact, the key to entry into the kingdom, the solid rock on which to build. As John's gospel puts it, Jesus has the words of life, and judgment depends on response to him and his words. Now, Klein Snodgrass, he raises the question of whether the teaching of this parable, whether it fits with Christian salvation theology. Let me read to you what he says, and then I know the bell will ring. He says, it might be better to ask if today's salvation teaching fits with the teaching of Jesus. That's how I'd put it. Because we've turned in some places Christianity into a caricature, a cartoon. But he says it might be better to ask. That's the second bell, right? Okay, let me finish this quote and then you're out. He says, it might be better to ask if today's salvation teaching fits with the teaching of Jesus. As Miroslav Volf complained, we may believe in Jesus, but we do not believe in his ideas. It is not the parable that is wrong, but our understanding of the gospel. Christian salvation teaching often emphasizes faith apart from works, which is translated as belief in certain doctrines without any action. It's what I call this sterile, intellectual, abstract belief without a surrender and submission. He says this is a distortion of Paul's theology. That's true. Does not fit with New Testament teaching at all, which everywhere stresses behavior and produces an abysmal result and an awful witness. Jesus stresses doing, as do Paul and every other New Testament writer, especially in the Sermon on the Mount. The parable insists that we change our salvation theology so that it conforms to Jesus' teaching and focuses rightly on a relation with Jesus that produces action. Without that, there is no biblical saving faith. That's what the Lord is saying. Thanks for staying overtime.